I have to confess that I'm really not very good with names, but it's some solace knowing that AI tools are way worse at this than I am. Welcome to Tales from the Jar Side. Welcome, my name is Ken Kousen, and on Tales from the Jar Side, I try to give you expert advice on Java, Groovy, Kotlin, Spring, AI, and related subjects. Let's take a look at a demonstration of how bad AI tools are at remembering anything, frankly. This is the website for the LangChain4j framework. It's a framework that allows me to use Java to access pretty much any significant AI tool out there. What you see now is a JUnit test that I put together called Conversation Test. And at the beginning, I'm using LangChain4j to create an instance of chat language model for GPT-4o mini. To demonstrate the stateless behavior, take a look at this little sample here. I have, of course, the famous scene from Princess Bride.
Hello, my name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die.
And then I ask it a second question right after the first one, which is, what's my name?
What's my name?
And I'll get both answers out of it as strings. I'll print them out and then I'll check. And what I want to verify is that Inigo is in the first answer, of course, but he's not in the second one. So let me run just this test. What you can see in the print here is the first response is, hello, Inigo Montoya. I understand your pain and your quest for vengeance. What can I do to assist you on your journey? And the second one says, I'm sorry, but I don't have access to personal data about individuals unless it has been shared with me in the course of our conversation.
That's not my name. That's not my name. That's not my name. That's not my name.
Therefore, I don't know your name. How can I assist you today? See, what a lot of people don't realize is that when you actually use the API, when you code to the API provided by OpenAI, all the requests and responses are stateless. Each request is independent of every other request. In the API, it doesn't remember anything. And therefore, we need a class called ChatMemory to fix that. There are a couple ways to handle ChatMemory in LangChain4j. Right now, we're going to look at doing it manually. This is arguably the hard way. It'll get a lot easier shortly when we use AI services. But let's see how this works. So the first line, the line I have highlighted here on line 46, is that my chat memory reference is assigned to a message window chat memory with max messages of 10. There's message window chat memory, and there's also token window chat memory, where you can keep the most recent whatever number of tokens you want to hold on to within the context limit. In this case, I'm going to use 10 relatively short messages, so it should be fine. The only problem is now I basically have to add all the previous requests and responses to the memory so that the AI will know what to do each time. So in this first one, I'll add my statement.
My name is Bond. James Bond.
Get a response from it and add that response also to the memory. Now, notice the argument to generate here was memory.messages. Grab all the messages that happen to be memory and send them along with the current request into the AI tool. So the second time, then I ask, what's my name? And again, I call it generate with all of the messages and get back a response this time and take a look at the result. And now I'm going to print them and run the test, and I'll show you that everything works out better this time. So you can see the first response to
name's Bond. James Bond.
Is, ah, Mr. Bond, a pleasure to meet you. How can I assist you today? Are you in need of a gadget, a mission briefing, or perhaps some martini recommendations? Shaken, not stirred, of course. And then the second response is, your name is
Bond. James Bond.
As it should be. Now, that was the hard way, because I had to manage all the messages myself, adding them into the memory. There are times when you have to do that. For example, if you decide to use more than one AI tool in the same application, they'll each have a memory. You'll need to manage the memory manually. But let's see that when we use the AI services capability in LangChain4j, it's going to make life much, much simpler. One of the best features of LangChain4j is a capability called AI services. With AI services, you just provide an interface and LangChain4j will implement that interface for you. So all you have to do is configure this thing and LangChain4j figures out everything else. I have a whole video on that, which is linked in the description and in your little pop-up here in case you want to see that. Well, here's the webpage that talks about how to handle chat memory when you're using AI services. So you use the AI services builder and put in your interface here. You specify which model you're planning to use. And then here's the key point. There's a method called chat memory where you're able to specify either the message window chat memory or the token window chat memory, either way. And once you've built that, then all the messages will be transmitted and saved automatically and you don't have to do anything else. Now, before I leave this, I want to show you, there's an additional example. If you look down here, you'll see that the assistant interface this time has a property in it with annotation at memory ID. This is going to allow us to have a separate chat memory ID for each user. So instead of doing chat memory, we'll be using chat memory provider for each ID, and that way we can keep multiple users separate. Let's take a look at both of those. Now this time, I'm going to use the AI assistant capability. The first assistant interface is right here, and you can see it just has a simple chat method that takes a string and returns a string, and that's it. And when I go to my test, I actually have a private method to create an assistant here, which uses AI services.builder on that assistant interface, specify the same model we've been using all along, and add the chat memory directly. The other assistant I'm going to use is this assistant per user. And you can see this time I have a user ID annotated with that memory ID and the string message annotated with user message. So this time in my private method, I can actually create the assistant per user by using the chat memory provider and just specify a field called memory ID, and that will take care of it automatically. We'll look at the test this time. We added in yet another message, but this is for just one chat memory object. So now we have Maximus here.
My name is Maximus Decimus Meridius, commander of the armies of the North, general of the Felix Legions, loyal servant to the true emperor, Marcus Aurelius, father to a murdered son, husband to a murdered wife, and I will have my vengeance. In this life or the next.
And when we ask the question, what's my name? This time we're going to get the right answer. Let's take a look. So the response we get is a powerful and iconic monologue from the film Gladiator. Maximus Decimus Meridius embodies themes of loyalty, vengeance, and honor. His tragic backstory and relentless pursuit of justice resonate deeply with audiences. Yeah, okay. Is there a specific aspect of the film or character you'd like to discuss? Yeah, I want to know his name. Your name is Maximus Decimus Meridius. Would you like to talk more about your character or the themes from Gladiator? No, that's good. Now let's take a look at the second one. In this case, I created an assistant per user. So this has that memory ID in it using the same model again. And this time there's my first question, which will be for Heisenberg.
Now, say my name, Heisenberg. You're goddamn right.
And the second one, let's go back to the 90s here and make a reference to good old Aqua Teen Hunger Force.
My name is Sheikh Sula, the mic ruler, the old schooler. You want a trick? I'll bring it to you.
But in either case, when we call the chat method, this time we'll specify user ID. I just happen to pick one or two, and I put them in a list just so I could print them out. But again, we'll check to see that the answers are what you'd expect. Now, in fact, we got a problem. First of all, it didn't say Heisenberg. It said, I am the one who knocks, which, yeah, okay, that's Heisenberg. So that worked, believe it or not. The second one, the GPT-40 mini misunderstood the rap song and it thought it was Rapper's Delight from the Sugar Hill Gang, which is wrong. Schoolie D is going to be very upset that we got that wrong, but so be it. Let me run it again, but this time I will use GPT-4o itself rather than just Mini. So much for me trying to take out the profanity with the asterisk. Anyway, GPT-4o is at your goddamn... Yeah, that's the response in the TV show. And the other one, it got, nice to meet you, Sheikh Zula. It sounds like you have some serious skills with the mic. Are you a fan of Aqua Teen Hunger Force? That's intro. It's iconic. Do you rap or create music yourself? So, anyway, that's working now. That's doing much better. It looks like it remembered both sides of it and we're good. Now, there's one last feature I want to show you, and that is persistence. Now, so far, all of our persistence mechanisms have been in memory. So even though I've had an implementation of the chat memory interface, it's only in, well, computer memory. So once the program shut down, all of that information was lost. You can, however, have that persist on your disk or in a database or something like that. In the documentation here, there's a section called persistence in the LangChain4j documentation, and they talk about implementing an interface called chat memory store. See, it's got get messages and update messages and delete messages. And then once you've made your own implementation, you can use that as the argument to the chat memory store method and thereby supply your own implementation. They gave us an example of this in the LangChain4j examples project. I'm using exactly what they did. In their example, they used a class called Persistent Chat Memory Store, and it takes advantage of a database that I'd never heard of, but something called MapDB. So this is at mapdb.org if you want to check out the web page for it, the documentation. And it's a nice programmatic way of making a trivial, simple, little efficient database. And it works in memory or it works on a file. This one's going to be in a file. So the idea is that inside their implementation of persistent chat memory store, they create a file called chatmemory.db on the local machine, make it transaction aware and everything. And it's going to be basically a map where we add things to a map and that'll get written to the database. So the get messages method just retrieves based on a particular user's ID what the messages are, and they have a static method to retrieve the JSON data and convert it into a list of messages for us. The update method will take the messages we supply as a list and convert them to JSON and then save them in the database again. And the delete messages just removes them. Each of those has a commit and we're all set. Now, the way I use this is I'll go back to my test case again here. And this time I instantiated that class as the argument to chat memory store. Again, create the builder with that chat memory in it. And this time I'm going to use mock.
My name is Mark, thanks a lot.
That is a seriously obscure reference. I don't know if more than two or three people who ever watch this video are going to recognize that one, but it's a song called My Name is Mock from a really old movie called Rock and Rule, as you can see here, which was an animated film from back in the early 80s, from 83. Some of us who happen to have seen it at the time still have some songs from it stuck in my head. Debbie Harry was in it. There were some good people in it. That doesn't mean it was a good movie. Seriously, don't go out of your way on this one. But the lead villain sang a song called My Name is Mock. And this was sung by Lou Reed. And if you look at the character, it's like, wow, this guy's really exaggerated. And I hear that it was supposed to be Mick Jagger. And that fell through because he was on tour. And then they went to David Bowie. And that fell through as well. Same reason. He had a really successful album and went on tour. And so they fell back on Lou Reed. And that's what we have. So long explanation for a silly example. So at any rate, I'm going to run this test by simply putting in a name. My name is Mock, thanks a lot, which is the lyrics there, and just get back an answer, which is a greeting. But then after that runs, I will come back and see if it worked as a persistent storage. So let me run this the first time. And you see, you're welcome, Mock. If you have any questions or need assistance with anything, please feel free to ask. So now I will comment out those three lines, and I will uncomment these three that's simply going to start with what's my name, and I'll print it and check that it has the name mock in it. So let's see how that one works. And sure enough, your name is mock. This has put a file in the root of my project called chatmemory.db, and that all worked. So I hope you enjoyed that. That was a bit more entertaining than I had in mind. So what have we learned? First of all, you don't want to do any of this by hand. It's better to use a framework for it. And LangChain4j is very good at that. LangChain4j allows you to access any of these tools. And the first thing to keep in mind is that all the requests to the API are stateless. If you don't do anything, then each request will be completely independent of every other one. However, with LangChain4j, you can create a chat memory instance either based on the number of messages you want to retain or the number of tokens you want to retain in each request. Basically, it automatically keeps track of the last whatever number of messages or tokens and supplies that with each subsequent request. This happens for you automatically. You can even do it in such a way that each user gets their own instance of chat memory as well. So that's convenient. And then finally, we were able to put in a persistence mechanism to save this so that even if the program shuts down in between executions, there'll be a persistent file. There'll be some way of saving this in between executions, and you can get back the old memory if you want to. Any of those are available. They all work very nicely. So to wrap up, I'm afraid I have to do this. I've got to bring in this one. Number one in the hood, G. Yeah, number one in the hood, G. I know I couldn't do that with a straight face. I'm sorry. See you in the next video.